architecture, and hopefully you get a chance to look at it with a lab tour. But they're mostly very, very thin sheet metals. And that means it's going to melt so easily, yeah, given the temperatures that you're operating. But anyway, that's something to note for homework number three, and you have the solution for it. So I would recommend taking a look at problem two and problem four, because that shows you the temperature drastic difference between both. Okay? Thursday, we'll talk briefly about the structure of the exam and all the logistics associated with it and whatnot, so we're not going to talk about it today. Today, we're just going to continue final flow. We're going over a view of the principal flow, so we'll continue final flow. Hopefully, get into normal shots and weak shots. And from there, we'll do CV nozzles, and that will wrap up our principal flow review that we need for this course. Okay, so last time we started doing fan flow. Actually, we worked on Rayleigh flow, and we did a few examples. We're gonna continue doing Rayleigh flow and do an example on it, then do normal shocks, and actually introduce a shock inside the fan flow. So, fan flow again, shock flow with friction. All this information is very important because I'm going to have you do the first project, which is mostly compressible flow based. It will be, I don't know timing wise yet because of the midterm and spring break and all that. I want to give you a break. So I'm trying to figure out when to give it and to give you enough time to work on it as well. So that will be the first project. And then the second project will be closer to the end of the semester. Okay, so fanal flow, we have a duct with some friction on it, with some length and some diameter to it. We apply conservation of mass, well, mass is conserved, and we got our flow momentum relative to our surface area forces equals to my shear stress forces that are being applied to the walls here. Primarily, I've got shear stress that's being applied to the duct here. And this coefficient C that we assigned earlier in our momentum equation ends up being our friction coefficient right here, multiplied by some 1 over C, obviously. But it's just some coefficient is a function of Reynolds number and roughness that is multiplied by my kinetic energy. And it's just simply some factor that represents my surface roughness, a smooth surface versus a rough surface. And this is typically measured in a sense, experimentally. So it's just some factor that you get. And sometimes it's actually a function of your Reynolds number, velocities that you have in there. So it's not always steady. It might fluctuate throughout the duct, but for the purposes of this course, we're always going to take it as constant. Always, the friction coefficient is constant. We apply conservation of energy, and one thing important that we notice here, I don't have any work, and it's primarily a process where my stagnation properties are constant. That's a critical information because what that says is my T stagnation here is equal to my T stagnation here. They're equal throughout. So that's very important information for resolving Fano flow, and that is not the case for Rayleigh flow. Then empirically, through experimentation, they drive this equation that represents a relationship between Mach number and the friction coefficient. This is F. This is F, or lowercase f, that's the friction coefficient. Relative to my displacement overall and delta. Now, if I take this equation and integrate it, so this is the formulation that I have relative to Mach number, and we talked about it last time, that it's simply like representing my shear flow on my boundary layer, and as a result of it, I'm getting an increase in velocity. That's really what it represents, and we said this is very similar to nozzle-like flow, so if I am entering with a low Mach number, subsonic flow into a nozzle, what happens? Well, the flow accelerates. So this is the same principle. So I'm creating a boundary layer right here, and that boundary layer causes the flow to actually accelerate, And if you have it long enough, you will get to the choking condition. And so it's simply a representation of it. This is, I think this was a discussion with your, one of your colleagues trying to say, well, you can actually expand this as a diffuser so you can mitigate the boundary layer behavior to keep your velocity constant if you wanted to. We talked about that. That's what I do in graduate fluids as a problem. Anyway, so disregarding this, this is just for discussion. Essentially, what I get here, due to friction, I get a boundary layer here, and that boundary layer causes my momentum and mass to actually be entrained into my main flow, and as a result of it, I start to get a higher velocity, which represents a nozzle-like flow, and that's why through fan of flow, you start with subsonic flow, which we drew the enthalpy and entropy flow here. For subsonic flow, if I'm starting right here, I will reach to a Mach 1 if I have a long, very long duct. And the opposite, if I'm at supersonic flow and I have friction, that's a disadvantage because it's actually stagnation pressure losses. I'm gonna have a stagnation pressure equation for it. And it results into the Mach number decreasing all the way to 1. Now, what if I have a shock wave? And we'll talk about it later, but essentially what we'll get is something like this. A sudden jump, obviously, from supersonic flow to subsonic flow. And if I'm coming this way on this leg, I'll march in this direction and then come down this if I have a long enough range. Actually, that's one of our example problems once we go over normal shocks. Anyway, so these are the equations. Now I have this integral right here. Assuming that friction coefficient is constant throughout my length, so simply if CF is equal to constant, which is going to be the case for this course, now, depending on the situation that you're working on, you want to consider if it is a variable, then it is a function of x and actually ends up being a function of Reynolds number. A Reynolds number is a function of velocity, and velocity varies throughout the whole x displacement. But let's not worry about it right now. Let's consider it constant and do the integration. That means 4 times constant divided over d, integrated over x. So what I end up with is 4 CF. And if I'm starting with location, if this is my duct, and this is my x displacement, and this is my origin, meaning x equals 0, so x1 is going to equal to 0. And x2 is going to equal to L, so when I do my integration, what I get is 4CFL divided by D is equal to this whole information right here, which is 1 over gamma m squared minus gamma plus 1 over 2 gamma natural log of m squared over 1 plus gamma minus 1 over 2 m squared. The whole thing, to the, obviously we need to go to the bounds with m2 versus m1. So if this is station 1 and this is station 2, it's the integration of the from Mach 2 to Mach 1. So all you need to do is substitute this equation and we'll do an example on it. This is the critical equation that we need to use for phantom flow. And generally, you will just go into the table, you can use your friction coefficient and whatnot, and you actually get the Mach numbers. But here, we're going to use the equation. So based on this, I could actually drive my relationships across the duct, which we said that the stagnation pressure, the stagnation temperature is constant, not the pressure. So I have T2 over T1. Well, I could say, well, that's equal to T stagnation 1 over T1 divided by T stagnation 2 over T2. So if I do the numerator and denominator correctly, then I'll end up with the same equation. Now, we just said that T stagnation 1 is equal to T stagnation 2 based on my energy equation, so these two terms actually cancel out. However, the idea is that I can use these relationships to drive function for T2 over T1. We already know this from my isotropic relationship is equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 over 2 M1 squared divided by, this is 1 plus gamma minus 1 over 2 M2 squared. So I can simplify the equation even more and say, well, T2 over T1 is equal to 2 plus gamma minus 1 M1 squared over 2 plus gamma minus 1, M2 squared. That's one relationship you use.
So it's easy to manipulate the equations based on knowing the fundamental isotropic equations that we already have, and some of the information like stagnation temperature is equal. Now, using this and using your ideal gas law, we already know ideal gas law P is equal to rho RT. So I could just say, well, P2 over P1 is equal to rho 1 R T1 divided by, rho 2. Rho 2 R T2 and rho 1 R T1. Well, R cancels over R, and I already have the critical information that I need. We typically don't want to work with density, so I already know that mass is conserved. Rho A is equal to constant. So assuming that my density is not, my area is constant here, so meaning rho 1 U1 A1 is equal to rho 2 U2 A2. Now we are assuming that the diameter is constant for the duct. It's not actually changing in size, so the area is equal. So I have A2, A1 equals A2, so that cancels out. And what I have is the density is equal to the density multiplied by velocity is equal to the downstream sign. So what is equal to is rho 2 over rho 1 is equal to U1 over A2. So based on this, I can take that information and substitute it here so I can work well with velocities. Now, why am I trying to get everything in terms of velocity? Because I already know from this, I can deduce the relationship of Mach number and speed of sound and use that information to get a representation of this equation of Mach numbers. That's what we're after. Because if we get everything in terms of Mach numbers, we can simply use the Mach numbers to figure out the upstream to downstream conditions of the duct. Now again, you don't have to know the derivations, but I'm just walking you through it, and essentially what you need to know is these equations at the end, and some of the equations I'm going to be deriving in a second. So based on this, we substitute it in there, and what do we get? We get P2 over P1 is equal to U1 over U2 multiplied by T2 over T1. Well, I already have a relationship for this. This is what I need to expand further, and I could say, well, that's equal to Mach 1, the speed of sound 1, meaning the Mach number is equal to U divided by the speed of sound, so I already know that relationship. I could just go and say F2 over M1 A1 over M2 A2 multiplied by T2 over T1. Now, I already know the definition of my speed of sound, so I could say, well,